I would suggest all my dear students to keep pen and paper ready, or you can make a separate notebook for Python so that you have all the notes in one place. I know we are living in tech age, and the age of notebooks and pens have gone far behind, because we can maintain notebooks in computer itself. Now, as this is our first lecture on Python, you might have thought that our teacher will teach us history of Python, who created Python, when Python was created, and what are advantages, disadvantages of Python. Nothing of that sort I am going to talk. Absolutely nothing. I am going to start directly with programming in Python. And I have set some aim. I want all my students to write at least 5 programs on their own in today's lecture itself. In your first lecture, you should be able to write at least 5 programs in Python on your own. So that is our, we are here obviously to learn programming. I mean, who cares when Python was created and all that? You can get it from Google. I don't care actually. You can get it from Google easily. So all those things which are available, your teacher need not tell you. I hope this screen is available, visible. Somebody please answer. Indrajit?
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. Fantastic. So, what I was telling is that before you run any Python programs, obviously you should have Python installed on your machine. So, how do you install Python? Although you might be knowing, I am telling you this again. Just Google out. Download Python. Simply. For Windows, nothing. Just download Python. You will be taken to the first page here. Check the page, python.org. Just click on this. And download the latest version for Windows. If you are using Windows, I usually use Mac. Today I am using Windows. If you are using Mac, you can click on this Mac OS here. Okay. Just download this. Download this. And one file will be downloaded which you run and simply keep accepting next, next, next and so on. But you know, I'll just warn you that when you actually run that downloaded file, just give me some time. When you run that downloaded file, you will get some window in the beginning where there will be a checkbox. Okay. There will be a checkbox below somewhere, and the option will be, do you want to add the Python path to system path? Do you want to add this Python to your system path? You make sure that you check this. Listen, if you don't check this, if you forget to check this, you know, you will have a lot of trouble later on executing Python programs. But that's it. This is the care you take. Just when you are running, you just see where is this option asked. So each and every window, you just keep checking. Don't just see next and click it. Okay. And it takes few minutes to download Python and to run that downloaded file. So this is how you install Python. Second thing that you need, this is the only thing you need to run Python programs. Just download Python. But you know, because we are going to learn, we are learning Python because we want to know machine learning. And you know, you have an excellent IDE called Jupyter Notebook. I'll better write it here. What you have, you know, is a very good IDE. IDE, which stands for Integrated Development environment, IDE. Now, what IDE is all about, you know, when you go to this IDE, you are allowed to type the Python programs and you are allowed to run the Python programs then and there. Here itself, you can run and see the output. So it's everything is integrated in this. Now, if you don't use this, then most often, you know, you will have to run the Python programs on command prompt. That becomes very difficult. So throughout, you know, our discussion for 120 hours, or rather more than that, we will be using Jupyter Notebook and all our Python programs will be written inside the Jupyter Notebook. But then how do you install Jupyter Notebook? Well, I told how do you install Python. How do you install Jupyter Notebook is, what you do is you Google out, download Anaconda. Now, Anaconda is an excellent tool. It's a collection of tools which contains Jupyter Notebook also. It's a very huge software, Anaconda. So you just go to Google. Yes. Yes.
Sir, can we use your VS Code?
Yes, you can. You can use PyCharm also. But I will advise all the students that to keep yourselves consistent, you know, with your teacher, it's better that you install, and it takes negligible time to install Anaconda. So I will advise you that you can go with me so that you can, and I can share you notebooks. I'll tell why I am teaching this in Jupyter Notebook. So you can obviously use it. You just say download Anaconda for Windows, or simply download Anacondas. And the first page it will take you here, anaconda.com. And you just scroll down. You can just click download here. That's it. Download. Okay. Now, after you download, you just run that downloaded file. But remember, again, when you run that downloaded file, in one of the windows, you know, in one of the options, there will be a checkbox. Just as I said about Python, add path to system path. And you make sure that you check this. Just as I said, while installation of Python, this option will be asked somewhere. And then just say next, and Anaconda will be installed. So two things you will have to install. I hope you will do it by the next lecture. I think our next class is tomorrow. Yeah. So first thing is you install Python. And second thing is you install Anaconda. Anaconda. Now, when you install Anaconda, you know, you get Jupyter Notebook. Now, what is Jupyter Notebook? It is nothing but a tool. It's a method. It's a tool given to type and run Python programs. What you have to do to run Jupyter Notebook? Just check this. Suppose you have installed all this. Okay. Now, what you have to do is simply go to command prompt, say cmd. Just check. It's not a big deal if somebody there, you know, is worrying, oh my god, so many things. We are going to do this every day, because to start Jupyter Notebook, we have to do this. So you will get used to this. Just click on command prompt by typing cmd, and you will get a command window. Here you just type Jupyter Notebook, that's all. Jupyter Notebook, and hit enter. Just check the spelling. It is Jupyter Notebook, P-Y-T-E-R, Notebook. And hit enter, Jupyter Notebook will start in Google Chrome. When you give this command, you know, Google Chrome automatically starts. And this Jupyter Notebook starts. Okay. I am not giving this command now, because I already have Jupyter Notebook started. Now, when you start Jupyter Notebook, you will get a home page. Check this. Home page like this. Okay, and I have created many files here. These are all Python files. But you will get blank over here when you first start Jupyter Notebook and you want to create a new file. So just click on this new and Python 3. You want to create a new Python 3 file. So when you click on this, you will see you will get a new page here. And this is a blank Jupyter Notebook file. Okay. And here you can type Python code. For example, if you write 2 + 2, simple. And you click on this run button. You see, this is the run button. So it is going to give output very soon. So that's the way how you actually type, install Python and Anaconda and then run Jupyter. Oh, it's taking a lot of time. What happened? Anyway, let it run. Let it enjoy its time. So.
Sir.
Yeah.
Will this startup is similar for macOS also?
What is similar?
So startup of Jupyter Notebook for macOS. Yes,
exactly. macOS also has terminal. In fact, I think tomorrow I am going to use Mac PC at my house. When I will start Jupyter Notebook, you will see Mac also has terminal window. And just go on the terminal window and type Jupyter Notebook. That's it. It will start. Okay. Pooja is joining. Okay. Now listen, everyone. Why I support Jupyter Notebook, you know, is because it is a notebook. Most of the times, my students do not have to maintain a separate notebook for Python. Because literally this notebook, you know, has notes, headings, and then programs. Just check below this. I have written some notes, explanation. And this literally is the notebook which you can share with your friends. Like I'll tell you, I have created one notebook long back, this untitled name. I'll open this notebook and show you what this is all about. Now, this is a rough notebook. I have used it as scratch pad. So this doesn't have anything interesting, okay? And let me open untitled 1.ipynb. Okay, this is about some Iris data set, and I was doing some project on machine learning on Iris data set, where I had to just plot some graphs to show the data dependencies. And I was discussing this with some of my students. So actually, you know, in notebook, you can't even draw this. And if on computer, you're having a notebook, which I share with you, that will be very interesting, isn't it? Okay. One more reason you just check why I support Jupyter Notebook is because Google offers Jupyter Notebook free for usage. So if you want to really kickstart your Python programming without doing any installation, I said you have to install Python, you have to install Jupyter Notebook, Anaconda, all that things, isn't it? But what if you want to really kickstart Python programming, then you just Google out. You can say Google. Collab stands for collaboration, Jupyter Notebook. You can just check this. And it will give welcome to collaborative. This first option, let's check this. Let's see what it does. Google collaborative. And huge thing is it starts Jupyter Notebook. Now this Jupyter Notebook is actually running on a Google machine. Although we are watching this on our screen, but this is running on Google Drive. I don't know where that server is. And superb thing about this, you know, nice thing is that you can create a new notebook. Check where the cursor is hovering. Just create a new notebook. Okay. I clicked on that. and it's loading. For first time loading, it might take some time. And given my laptop, it's not that fast. You see, here is the Jupyter notebook, and I'm typing the code here. Like if I say 2 + 2, okay, and I click on this run button. Wow, it's taking a lot of time. I think my 2 + 2 has gone to Google, and now Google is actually watching this. Ah, you see this. Why is this not showing any output? I don't know what happened. Okay. But then you see this. This 2 + 2 I have executed. You watch this. And it has given output 4. Just check. And you can run this Google Colab Jupyter Notebook without any installation. You don't have Python on your system. You don't have Anaconda. All your machine learning programs will run. That's a superb thing that you have. One more thing. If you are running these programs on Google machine, don't you feel you will have very good speed? Because you are running your programs not on 4-core or quad systems. You are running it on a very, very high-end machines. So you have that great advantage. So it's better that we keep our Python notebooks instead of using any other software. I hope most of you agree. Somebody there on chat, I think. Wait a minute. What's the latest chat? Girish Dumal said, yes, sir. Okay. Okay. Let me check the names again. Anmol?
Yes, sir.
Are you satisfied that we should go for a Python notebook, Jupyter notebook?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Nitin, what do you say? Hello, Nitin.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fantastic. What about Prachi Godbole? Hello, Prachi.
Sir, I have just joined the meeting because I was...
Yeah, it's okay. But we are going to write Python programs in Jupyter notebook.
Okay,
if you are new to it, just keep watching. Okay, we will be repeating a few things.
Right. Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. Rahul Pillai.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, are you okay with Jupyter notebook?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay. So, I'll keep this collab open. Although Google allows you to use Colab continuously for 9 hours only. After 9 hours, you won't be allowed to use. Then you will have to again start Google Colab by clicking on that option. But 9 hours is a lot. What was I saying? Okay. Assuming that you have installed Python and Anaconda, we have started discussion of Python. Those who have joined late, I'll make an announcement again. Although this is our first lecture on Python, I want all of you to get the taste of programming today itself. And I want my students to write at least 5 programs on their own. So please keep your notebooks and pen ready. Okay, here is my first code of Python. And if I make an announcement, no need to explain this. It is not an exaggeration. Where A is 10, B is 20, C is 30, because C is A plus B. And then print C, as the name suggests, is going to print value of C, and value of C is 30. So if I run this code by clicking anywhere over here, I run this code. It's going to give me output 30. By the way, this statement print C has printed the value of C, which is 30. Now, everyone, try to understand some words, some terms. This A is called variable. This B is called variable. C is also variable. Variable is nothing but which can vary, which can change. For example, our age is a variable. It is changing even now. My salary is a very good example of variable. And you wish that it should always increase. Please wish a better thing for me. But salary is a very good example of a variable. Score in a computer game is a variable. If you do something really good, score increases. If you play poorly, score decreases. And when you use variable, the intention behind using a variable is just one. Just the intention is store a value, that's all. Next time if somebody asks you, why do you need variables in programming? You say, variables are necessary to store values. Finished, period. If somebody asks you more on that, you say variables store value and later on their values can change. So you can increase the value, you can decrease the value, like score increases or decreases. So A, B, C are variables. And they are storing 10, 20 respectively, and C will become 30, and this print is going to print 30. You can see, when I click on this run button, you know, the output gets displayed right here, down here. This is the output of the program. Now just see, if I give this C in the inverted comma, like this, quotation, open quote and close quote, just check this. Okay, entire program I have kept same, except I have written print C in quotation. Now when I run this code, it's going to print C. Just check the output. So what is the basic thing that you have to understand while learning print command? When you learn print of Python, the rule is, printf is in C. Just had a class of C in the morning. Okay. Print bracket. When you give quote, and you write whatever in the quote, and bracket close, then this material that you have written in the quote will be printed as it is on the screen. For instance, if you write print quote 3 plus 4. Now, what do you think? The output will be 7? No way. Output will be 3 plus 4. Due to this, output is literally 3 plus 4. So whatever you give in quote with printf is printed as it is. So what happened is, you gave print C, but C was given in the quote. So C was printed as C. Just check this. Give me some time. Okay. The point is that I am not interested in printing letter C. I am interested in printing value of C, where C is a variable. So when I don't give the quotation, okay, Python understands that you are not interested in printing letter C, but C is a variable and its value should be printed. Here we go. So 30 is the output. Simple, isn't it? Simple. Very easy. Just declare to, just use two variables, add them, store in C, print C. That's it. And then here in my notebook, I have made an explanation. In Python, you can use variables directly without declaration. In the above program, A equal to 10 means what? B equal to 20 means what? C equal to A plus B means what? Okay. Now, please excuse me for this. What I am teaching now may not be known by everyone. If you are genuinely new to programming, okay? But just forget it as a bad dream if you have not got this. This, whatever I am explaining in next 2 to 3 minutes, is not at all important. But there are some languages, computer languages like C, C++, Java, in these languages, variables must be declared before their use. That means suppose you want C to become equal to A plus B. Suppose, then you should declare C, declare A, declare B. How you declare them is by writing, I have a variable int A, B, C. I warn all of you again, ignore this if you're not understanding. But comparison sometimes becomes necessary. What this line means is that we are declaring three variables, A, B, C, and all have data type. Now this int is data type called int. What this data type is? Simple. Data type means type of data. That's it. Type of data. When you say A, B, C are integers, then A, B, C can store only integer values like 10 or 20, 0, minus 8. All these are integers. Why? Because these are whole numbers. Whole numbers. Whereas in C, if you say float A, B, C, check the word float. Now A, B, C are variables of type float. Now data type associated with ABC is a float. So you can now store values like 10.5, 20.8, 0.6, minus 8.3, 9.8, any such value. These are all floating point numbers. What that means is all these languages, you know, are called strongly typed languages. Oh, what a word, what a term. Strongly typed languages means, it says, look, if you want a variable, then in advance tell me what is the name of that variable and what type of value it stores. Both the things you have to tell in C, C++ or Java. And then you can use it, freely use. But listen, if you don't write this line and you directly start using this, you are going to get error in Java or C, saying that I don't know who is B, what kind of value is A, B, and C. So that's why these are called strongly typed languages. Let me check. Anybody chatting? No, no chats. Let me go to participants. Prasanna Joshi, are you comfortable?
Yes, yes, sir. I'm listening to you.
Okay.
It's really good.
Samruddhi Salvi, are you comfortable? Okay, some mic disturbance at Samruddhi's place. Shubham Shelar,
are you? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, Samruddhi, I heard something. Okay. So, what I was telling is these languages, C, C++, Java, are strongly typed. You have to tell each time, please, I need a variable. It should be int. Now I can use it. So, int A, okay. Now C is happy. A is int variable. Now you can use it. But that's not true about Python. What Python says, you need a variable, don't declare it. Simply say, A is 10. That's it. A is 10. So what Python does when this line runs A equal to 10, it creates a new variable called A in the RAM. Listen, very importantly, any variable, you know, is always stored in the RAM, random internal memory, RAM. So if this is RAM, very childish picture, imagine this is random access memory. Due to this line, there is a variable A whose value is 10. Done, stored in the memory. Then there is a variable B whose value is 20, done. And then due to this line, C becomes a new variable whose value is 30. And then this line prints the value of C. So variable always has its place in the RAM. Okay. Nice. That means you don't have to declare a variable in Python. You just say, I need a variable, A equal to 10, B equal to 20, it will make those variables. Now, due to this, you know, most confusing aspect in students' mind due to this is that students start feeling that there are no data types in Python. Because in C, you write int A, right? Int ABC. So data type is seen. Int data type, float data type. But you never write anything like this in Python. Hello? If you are asked how many data types are there in Python, your answer should be there are many data types. Many data types in Python. And beginners often feel that there is no data type because you don't have to declare anything. Look, the numerous data types in Python are int, float, okay, str stands for string, then bool stands for boolean, okay. Then we have a data type called, let me recall, list, then tuple, then set, okay, dictionary. And I might have missed out a few things, but these are some commonly used data types. So we have long list of data types. Let me go back to Python code. Okay. You just check that actually in our notebook we have written every variable in Python has a data type. Definitely has a data type. Various data types I have written here. And if you want to really know, when you make a equal to 10, you see a equal to 10, what is the data type of a? You can find out by writing print type a. Just check the grammar. Type A. So it will tell which type of variable is A. Like you see, I have written a small code here. I'll just cut down a few things over here. Check this code. A is 10. Now A is a variable. What is its data type? Automatically, Python will make A as int. Why int? Why not float? Because we have written 10 here and 10 is an integer. So A becomes integer type of variable, and internally in the RAM it is registered like that. A is a registered variable with type int. So when you actually print type of A, type bracket A, and when you run this code, you can see it prints that it is int. That means type of A that we have printed is int. That confirms that A is an integer. Okay, just ignore this word class. Huh? I know you are looking at that. Why class int? It's enough for one to know today that A is really an integer. But what if I change this A to 10.5? Let's say. Now A will be float. Just check. If I say type A and if I run this, just check this. Yeah, A is a float. Okay. But what if I say A is Samir? Let's say. But you see, I have written Samir in quote. Single or double quote, anything would do. I have written it in quote. Then A becomes a string. So if I find the type of A, it will be str. Or what if I say A is true? Just check, T is in capital. This true or false is known as Boolean value from Boolean algebra. And some things in this real life can be either true or false. Can be either true or false. For example, is Samir married? This can be either true or false. Nothing in between that. Obviously. Isn't it? Or if you ask, is Samir intelligent? Then it might have three answers. True, false, or don't know. Anyway, but if A is true, this is Boolean. If I print the type of A by running it, this is bool, you see. So who says that variables don't have data type? I mean, I only said that. Every variable has a data type. It is recognized by the data type. Only thing is you don't have to care about data type. One more nice thing about these variables is, suppose I say A is 10. Okay. And if I ask you which type of variable is A, you will quickly now say it is int variable, int type. Correct? And suppose after this line, if I say A is equal to 10.5, note this, 10.5. Now I ask you, which type of variable is A? You will say, sir, it was int some time back, but now it has changed and it has become a float variable. That's such a nice feature of Python, you know. But what happens in old languages like C, C++, that when you write this line, int ABC, then A will remain int and it can't store anything else other than int. It's strongly typed language. But here you are free to change A from int to float. So suppose now I say printf, print type A. Now you see, here it will print type A as int, but here it will print type A as float. Let's try. It will print two outputs, obviously. First time it prints int, and second time it prints float. That shows that you can dynamically change the type of a variable. Nice, isn't it? Okay. So, actually, you know what? See, the first language I learned was C language, obviously, way back in 1991, I think. And I read the textbook written by Moolish Cooper. Now it is not available. It is out of print. But I read one very interesting line written by Moolish Cooper in the preface. I had that habit of reading books from the preface. Okay. And Moolish Cooper says that if you want to learn any programming language, then start learning programs in that language. And while learning programs, you try to learn the language. Absolutely opposite happens in most of the textbooks. Are they start with history of Python, who created Python, and then keywords of Python. Oh my God, that is pathetic. Keywords. They give a big table of keywords. Are what am I going to do with those keywords? As if I am going to remember all the keywords. And hell lot of first 50 pages, they just spend like that. Here we are, after learning the type of a variable. What do you mean by type of a variable? Let's see. Let's see the program for adding two numbers again. Just check this. Same program. You all know A is 10, B is 20, C is 10 plus 20. So C is 30. And print C means print 30. Just check this. This is going to print 30. I'll just scroll up. Okay. Just same program we are looking at again. But you know, when you see that output 30, you are not impressed. As a user, you know, you're not impressed on seeing that output. You'll say, what, sir? No, so? No, we are impressed. No problem. Now, you just check. Okay, it has printed 30, addition of 10 and 20. But what is this 30? Mm-hmm. No, not so fun. What is that 30? It should have printed sum is 30, something like that. It should have printed, correct or not? You may write very good programs, but if you are not able to print formatted outputs, outputs which will certainly help user understand what's happening. What is this output? If you just print 30, it's not understood. So what if we want to print, let me go to the blank screen again. What if we want to print the output like this? Watch this. I'll write that code again over here. A is 10. B is 20, C is A plus B. And then the code is print C, simply print C. That's it. So this is printing value of C, which is 30. 30 is the output. But we want the output. Please give some time. I'll just erase this. Okay, we want the output to be like this. Output should be, just in short, I have written OP. Output should be sum equal to 30. Oh, this will be great. So obviously last print statement should change. Last print should change because this print is printing the output, isn't it? So what we will do is we will give print like this, quotation, sum equal to quotation close, then comma C. This print is going to print this output. Now short while back I told, whatever you give in the pair of quotes is printed as it is. I hope you remember. So this sum equal to is given in quotes. So this sum equal to this portion will be printed as it is. But after that, we have given C without quote. So Python understands that C is a variable and its value should be printed. I hope you are understanding. Just check. If I write this print like this, this is very silly what I am writing. Sum equal to C quote close. Oh, good Lord. I hope you understand. This is going to print sum equal to C. That's it. Letter C it will print. Because whatever you give in quotation is printed as it is. But we want sum equal to be printed, and then we don't want to print C, but we want to print its value. So you can watch here that C has been given after this quote, after this quote. But between this quote and C, there is a separator called comma. That's there in the grammar, that's there in the rules. That when you print some string, something like sum equal to, followed by a variable, then you better separate them with a comma. That's the rule. Okay, so this is going to print that very good output, like sum equal to 30. Let's go to this page and let's change this code. Okay, I say sum equal to, quote close is already there, comma C, and then close bracket. Now let's run this. This is going to print sum equal to 30. Great. This is good. But even this is not impressive. And now you will say, come on, sir, this is okay. But this is not good. I mean, what I want you, I can do better, actually. Please give me some time. I want to just erase a few things. Well, tomorrow you will have a maybe better experience when I work on Mac. Wow, that machine is really fast. Anyway. So what is the output I want? I want sum. Oh, please, sorry. Sum of 10 and 20 is equal to 30. Oh, great. Just see this output. Just check the output. Sum equal to 30. Okay, fine. This output is also okay. But this seems to be much better, which is actually printing what am I adding and what is the sum. So what is the print? Print should change, obviously. What change we should do? We should say sum of, okay, and we will end the quote. Now, why we have ended the quote after sum of is because I want a value of a variable. Whose value is this? A. Notice A is 10. So I'll give comma A. Just observe. Okay. After the value of A, I want the word and. So I will place a comma and start the quote and again give and. Quote close. You know, whatever is given in quote is printed as it is. And then again I will give comma because after and I want to print B. Value of B, not B is 20. So I'll give B. After that I'll give comma because I want equal to. Check this. Down below, I want equal to, and after comma, I will give in quote equal to. And then again, I will give comma, and finally, I want value of C. So after comma, I will give C, and then close the print. So this is printed as it is. This prints value of A. This is printed as it is. This prints value of B. This equal to is printed as it is, and this prints value of C. So let's try this first and then I will interrogate with some students. So this statement I am changing now. Sum of quote close, comma A, comma and. Single quote or double quote, anything will do, but I am using double quote. And A and comma B, comma equal to C. Let's try running this code. Sum of 10 and 20 equal to 30. Great. I hope you liked it. This is the way how you can print the outputs. Yes, Shiva. Shiva Ramakrishna.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. Have you done any programming before, Shiva?
No, sir.
Absolutely nothing, bit of C, C++, something?
Yeah, I've done Turbo C++.
Okay, good. What about Shubham Shelar?
Yes, sir. I do programming in Java.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Okay. We have Vaidehi here. Vaidehi, are you understanding this? Hello, Vaidehi. Is Vaidehi on chat? No. We have Manikant Verma here. I hope I can call you Mani. Can you hear me? Oops. What happened? Anyway. Okay. Now I am scrolling a few things here. Please excuse me. I am not telling you this format. I planned that I will tell you today. But I am just scrolling. Okay. Now the next lesson I am giving you is that look. We know how to add two numbers. Make A as 10, B as 20 and C is A plus B and print C. But then this is no fun. Because we are storing value of A and we are storing value of B. What if we want that the user should be able to enter the value of A and B from the keyboard? So whatever values user will enter, those values will be added. That will be good. So just check in Python, you know, there is a statement called input. And input is followed by bracket. Just bracket, that's it. And you give some prompt here, enter first number. Okay. So this will allow user to input a number. Just check. Input is actually a function I will call a statement. Right now I will call it as a statement. It's actually a function. And it allows user to input a value. It's better that I run this code directly and show you later on. After that, we can see what it does. So when I run this code, see, it is asking me enter first number. Actually, this material that I have given in the quote here, you know, is getting printed here as a prompt. And now I should input some number, say 10. And after hitting enter, now it will ask me second number. This is the second input, enter second number. So suppose I enter a value like 20. Now it will print the output 30, you see. Of course, we can improve this last statement by putting sum equal to and all that. You know that now. So it will then print sum equal to 30. Fine. But important thing is, how do you take input in Python? Just check this. How do you take input? Very simple. And now those who have learned C, you use scanf. Those who have learned C++, you use cin. Correct? Those who have learned Java, you use buffered reader or data input stream. Some kind of function you use and classes you use to take the input. But here in Python, simple way is just write input. And you are going to input some value. Correct? Where should that value get stored? If you want that value to be stored in A, you write A is equal to input. Input. Now, you are going to input some value. You want to tell Python, where will that inputted value go? You say B should store that inputted value. Simple. So A will take the value of the input, B will take the value of the input. Now, here in the bracket of the input, you give some message like enter first number. So this message will be a help for the user. User will know what has to be entered. Here you can say enter second number. Like enter your username, enter your password, something like that. And then that text box appears, isn't it? Now, fact about input. Sad, but it is a fact. The point is that suppose you were asked enter first number. Just as you saw, enter first number. And there was a text box here. Hai na? You saw this. And you entered 10. So what did you input? You input 10. So 10 should be stored by A. But this 10 will be taken as a string. I know you don't know much about strings. But actually, you know, this will not be a number. This will be a string. Similarly, when you are asked to enter second number, just see, second number, and the text box, you enter 20, you will feel that B will store 20. No, no, B stores 20, but B stores string 20. Please try to understand this. Although maybe difficult on the first day. But both A and B are not numbers. So it is rubbish if you say C is equal to A plus B. Rubbish. If A and B are not taken as numbers, they are taken as strings. What sense does it make by saying string 10 plus string 20? This is a rubbish statement. So what Python offers, Python says, okay, you have entered 10 feeling that it is a number. For you as a user, this is a number, I agree. I mean, you will tell your friend, I have entered number 10, I have entered number 20, you will tell. But this 10 and 20 is taken as strings. Now, you can convert a string into integer very quickly by writing int bracket A. What is A? A is 10. Look how I am writing A. Value of A is 10. It's a string. And we are saying that please convert this string into an integer. So what if I say A itself stores this value. A is equal to integer of A. Like that you can write. You can read. So A will be perfectly a number 10. You can imagine that these quotes are removed now. I hope you are understanding. B is also a string, isn't it? So you will have to say B is equal to int B. So B will become integer value of B. And remember, B was string 20. So it becomes numeric 20. Now this is 10 plus 20. Now it makes sense and C becomes 30. Okay. I could see 22. Now there are 20 candidates. So some people are jumping in and out. But I don't know, it might be due to bad internet connection also. Let me ask a few students. I could see Mani. Mani is not there now. Okay. Indrajit, I talked to you in the beginning of the class. How are you doing, Indrajit? Comfortable?
Good. Yes, sir.
Dhanashri?
Yes, sir.
You are very comfortable?
Yes, sir.
Okay, have you done any programming in past?
Yes, sir, in C and C++ language.
Okay, very good. And I am sure, Dhanashri, you might be knowing a few things which I am telling you today in Python. Okay, that's your modesty, but you might be already knowing it. Okay. coming back to this code, I hope you have understood. See, A will take the input, but A will be a string. B also will take the input, but B is a string. And then I actually convert this A into int and B into int. And then I make C is equal to A plus B and print it. So if I actually run this code, check, it's going to ask me enter first number. Suppose I enter, say, 55. So actually, you know, A will be string 55. But then this line here will convert that string 55 into numeric 55. On hitting enter, it will ask me second number. If I enter 66, then B, due to this line, will be string 66. But this line will convert B into numeric 66. And both will be added and C will be 121. This is the way how you take the input, process the input by converting it into a particular value that you want. Now, what have you seen till now? Let's summarize. The class that was held till now, what did we see? Well, we saw simple print statement. Okay. How to print formatted outputs like sum equal to 30. This was done by writing print sum equal to comma C. Second thing we learned is, what do you mean by data type and variable, and how Python is not strongly typed. But you can easily find out the data type of a variable by using type A, where A is a variable. So if you say print type A, and if A is 10, then this is going to print int, because A is really storing int value. Another thing that we understood was how to take input using input function. But anything that you input is always taken as a string, So you will have to convert it into the type that you want. Okay. Now I am again ignoring the next part. I am scrolling down and let's try a program now. Just check this program, everyone. A very simple program to find area of circle. Okay. So I'll write it here. And question is, we want to write a program to find area of circle. Area of circle. So what do you have to do? You know, you will have to input radius. So user will give radius of circle. So we'll say R is equal to input, enter radius. So suppose input given by the user was 3.5. Now 3.5 will be taken as string and stored in R. You know this. But then I want R to be a float. So what I will do is I'll write R is equal to float R. Just as I wrote int R, I will write float R. So if R is a string 3.5, literally this R will become 3.5. It will become a perfect float. And now I will write A is equal to 3.14 into R. Remember, formula of area of circle is pi R square. So this is pi. This is R into R is R square. And finally, I will print A. So input the value of radius, convert radius into float because it will be string, then find area using the radius, and finally print area. That is what I have written here. Enter radius, R is float R, and A is 3.14 into R, and then I'll just change this. Please excuse me here. I got carried away and I have written this. Area of circle equal to comma R. So if I run this, this is going to ask me to enter radius, isn't it? What if I enter 3.5? Now listen, this 3.5 will be taken as a string in R, and then we are converting into a float. And now when I hit enter, this is going to calculate the area and print area of circle is, I by mistake printed R. People might be laughing at me. I should print A. Because A is the area. By mistake, I printed R here. Okay. Let me run the program again. If I enter 3.5, this is going to print area is 38.465. I hope you have got this. So, Rishikesh, are you ready for solving some programs in Python now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Anmol?
Yes, sir.
I'll be glad if you write these codes on your own, and whoever raises hand first may tell us how to write these programs. Just simple programs to be written in Python to begin with. Here is question number one. Keep your pen and paper ready. Write a program where user will input, user means we, user will input, let's say base and height of triangle, and program will find area of triangle. So you think of here that two variables B and H will be needed. So you will have to input the value of B and value of H. And then the formula for area is, as you all know, half into base into height. Now half, cannot be written like this, 1/2. Please try to understand. You can't write like this. You will have to write 1/2. Or the best thing is you can write 0.5, half base into height. And then you print area. Now, question 2 I want all of you to solve is, user will input. Please give me some time. Just check this. User will input. This is very interesting. I'm curious to know how you are going to write this. User will input end. What am I writing? Sorry. Input coordinates. Coordinates of endpoints. Endpoints of a line. Of a line. Let's say those coordinates are x1, y1. And x2, y2. And the program should find slope of the line. Now, as all of you know, if you call m as slope, then m is given as y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. Just check this. If you have a point x1, y1 and x2, y2, if you have these two endpoints, these are called endpoints of the line, isn't it? Then the slope of the line is y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. And then you have to find slope and print it. Somebody please acknowledge me so that let's say Mayur. Mayur Adsul.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You will do this? You will try these two codes?
Yes, sir. I'll try.
Now. Okay. Good. So, Mayur is representative of all of you. And I'm sure everybody will be up and actually trying this. Okay, dear students. Let's see both the codes. Base and height of a triangle. Anybody raising hand? Indrajit. Hello, Indrajit.
Hello, sir.
Have you written the code for the first one?
No, sir. No, sir. I'll show you tomorrow, sir.
Okay. But I guess you are having pen and paper. Just see, you are trying to write it now. Nitin? Hello, Nitin. Nitin? Hello? Rishikesh Prabhu?
Yes, sir.
Are you writing the code?
Sir, I have written for second one.
Second one? Okay, here we go. We have first participant. So I will go to an empty tab here. Okay, this is fine. Okay. Tell us, what code have you written?
Sir, I have written first A, B, C, D values as H1, H2 and Y1, Y2.
How did you write it? A?
A is equal to input, enter H1.
In quotation, right?
Yes, sir.
Enter X1. Okay. But you could have named this as X1 itself. No problem. So, you are calling coordinates as A, comma B, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's fine. So, I will help you with the rest. You wrote A as input X1. Then you must have written B as, what did you write? B is equal to?
H2.
X2, okay. X2, is it? Okay. Then, C is equal to? What did you write? C is equal to?
Y1.
Okay, Y1. C is Y1. And now it's obvious that you must have written D is equal to enter Y2. Okay, D. Now all these values need to be converted, hai na?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so what did you write?
Sir, A is equal to float A.
Okay, good. That's it. You did it. Okay, did it. So B is equal to float A, float B. Float B. C is equal to float C. And D is equal to float D. Okay. Okay. All are floats now. Now what did you write further?
Print slope is comma S. Print
slope equal to comma
S.
S. But what is S?
Did you tell sir? Sir, yeah, I put S is equal to D minus C upon B minus E.
Upon B
minus E.
Minus E? A, you mean. Okay, A. Right. A slash, na? Upon means slash. Okay. Let's see. Any brackets given here in this line?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So, here we go. Congratulations for our first code. Okay. This is absolutely right. See, what has been done is, four variables A, B, C, D have been taken, and A is termed as X1. So if you have this line, then this X1 over here is A, okay? And B has been termed as X2, you see. And C is Y1, okay? And D is Y2. Observe this. D is equal to value of. So the points are A, C and B, D. All these four points are entered and their floats have been found. Now you know the formula S, the slope is given as Y2, that is D. See, Y2 is D minus Y1, that is C. Correct? D minus C divided by, you watch, it can't be D minus C slash, na? Because there is no slash on my keyboard. Upon is not there on the keyboard. It can be only this symbol, division. So divided by X2. X2 is B minus X1. That is A. So this will be the slope. And then finally, this boy is printing the slope. Okay. But there is something that is, of course, I appreciate the program that you have written. But there is something which is missing here. Brackets were needed over here. Now you missed out that because I have not taught you this concept. The brackets were needed at both places. Okay, but before I write that correct statement, let me ask someone here. Anmol.
Yes, sir.
What do you say about these brackets?
Sir, the bracket will first minus the subtract the given values and then divide with the upon value.
Correct. Okay. So first brackets will be solved. Absolutely right. Dhanashri, what do you say?
Same, sir.
Yeah, brackets are necessary. Okay. Saket Rao. Saket.
Yes, sir. Same thing, sir. Because mathematics are according to Bodmer's rule, first the bracket will be solved. So.
Correct. You are pointing to Bodmer's rule of maths. Correct. Okay. Sorry, I was wrong. Bodmer's rule of the world, not of maths. Okay. Siddhant? I guess there is only one Siddhant here. Siddhant Dhavane? Velaga Hemu Sai. Correct I am pronouncing?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do you agree with this?
Yes, sir. I agree, sir.
Agreed and completely well written code. I am very happy for that. Okay. So what is the point here is, the point is that you have got the points A, C and B, D, and you are finding slope. Now slope formula is D minus C. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'll write it here. D minus C divided by, correct? B minus A. B minus A. Now the problem here, you know, in mathematics or rather in Python, division has got higher priority, higher importance than subtraction. So what Python will do, although you have written this division after subtraction, it will do C upon B first. It will divide first and then it will subtract. But we don't want this. We want that this subtraction should be done, then this subtraction should be done, and finally division should be done. See, this problem doesn't occur when we write it in general algebra. In algebra, when we write S is D minus C whole thing upon, we so clearly write upon B minus A. So reader understands, okay, I have to first solve this, then solve this, and finally do division. But problems evaluating with slash operator, you can understand that when you write S is D minus C slash B minus A, then division will be done first. We don't want that. So we will put these two things in the bracket. And the global rule of maths is brackets are always solved first. So D minus C solved, then B minus A solved, and then finally division done. And then we can print the slope, obviously. Somebody on chat, wait a minute. Two chats here. Oh, that's from Ikeda. I'm sure all of you are enjoying the session to take admission to the batch. Do contact me on 977-3565 and so on. Okay. By the way, coming back to our code. But I appreciate this boy's efforts. Okay. So here we go. We put this in the bracket here. D minus C. And B minus A. Now the formula is correct. Now I'll run this code. What should I take? Let's take 0, 0 and 1, 1. Now those who are from mathematical background knows that if one point is 0, 0 and other point is 1, 1, is 1, 1, then the slope, what will be the slope? Slope has to be 1, right? Because 1 minus 0 divided by 1 minus 0 should be 1. Correct? So I will give A comma C. These are A comma C, na? The first point. And the second point is B comma D. So look, I will give A and C as 0 and B and D as 1, 1. These, remember, these are X1, Y1 and this is X2, Y2. Okay. So let's run this code and check. It is asking me enter X1. X1 is 0. But X2 is 1. Then Y1 is 0. Yeah, X1, Y1 is 0, 0. Na? And X2, Y2 is 1. Now the slope is 1.0 exactly. Slope is 1.0. Please try to understand what I did in last few minutes. Look, as a programmer, you write your program. Correct? Then you want to test it, whether it runs or not. Correct? Now, if I ask you a question, who knows what is slope? The answer is, Indrajit knows what is slope. But Python doesn't understand what is slope. You give it a formula, it will evaluate and tell what is slope. If you know what is slope, then you should enter the values in such a way that you know in advance what will be the output. Please try to understand something called testing, testing of program. Well, I have seen in the past as a teacher, you know, many boys and girls running this code like this. When it says enter X1, they enter something like 100, something, 100. Then enter X2, they enter 105. Then Y1, 35 or 356 and Y2, 345. And it sincerely prints slope. Uska kya galti hai na? It prints slope. Aray, but are you sure that this answer is correct? How do you confirm that your program is correct? So what I usually do whenever I run any code, you know, I will take some sample input. And in my mind, I already know what answer I should get. And once I get the correct answer for those inputs, I'm sure my program is correct. So don't give any arbitrary inputs. When you run your program, you be ready with the inputs. And you tell that this is the input I am giving, this is the output I must get. And if you get it, good, go for a cup of coffee. I hope you got something from this last few minutes discussion. Just don't run the program just because you are running and it gives some output. For instance, the slope of the line. What if I say that I'm going to enter the first point as 0, 0 and the second point as 1, 0, let's say 1, 0. Oh, that means the slope should be y2 minus y1, that is 0, upon x2 minus x1, that is 1. But 0 upon 1 is 0. So the slope for these inputs must be 0. Remember, this is x1, y1. This is x2, y2. So if you run the code for this input, it should give slope as 0. So it is asking me x1. Remember, x1 is 0. It is asking me x2. Remember, x2 is 1. y1 is also 0 and y2 is 0. It will give slope equal to 0.0. Congratulations, your program is correct. Now you can give any arbitrary input. Who cares? And you are sure that whatever output it gives is correct. Okay. Shiva Ramakrishna, do you want to say something?
No, sir.
Ah, fantastic. That means you got this completely. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Shubham Shelar.
Yes, sir. I understand.
You understand. Very good. Okay. Now, let's go for one more trouble. I say trouble. Whenever there is a code, there is always a trouble. But let's say that I want to write a program like this. See, I don't know whether all of you are from science background, but because I am a computer engineer, I am from science background. Whatever examples I take, you know, are from geometry, probability, statistics. I don't like the examples of something like compound interest, simple interest, or banking application, something like that. So here is the question. User should input. Oh, there was one more question I forgot. What an absent-minded person. There was one more question for entering, I think, base and height of triangle and finding area. Let's return to that later. Okay. User should input coordinates of endpoints of a line. Let's call that coordinate of a line. Let's call that coordinates as x1, y1 and x2, y2. Sorry for bad handwriting, but you can't do anything about 50-year-old person. My age of improving handwriting has already passed by. I can't do anything about it. Okay. So these are the endpoints of a line. And the question asked is, program should find length of the line. This length, how big the line is, or distance of the line. And now you know from geometry, if you say L is the length, L is given by square root of x1 minus x2 the whole square plus y1 minus y2 the whole square. A Euclidean distance we call it as. Just take x1, take x2, subtract it, but find square of it. Okay. And then take y1, y2, subtract it, but take square of it and you add these two quantities and then find square root of the entire thing. Okay? So this we want to do. The big thing is we have already written half of the program. Not half, 90% we have written. Just check this. What do you have to enter? X1, X2, Y1, Y2. That we have already done two endpoints. And we have also converted A, B, C, D to floats. The only thing is, if you have two endpoints, we want to find out the length of the line. Somebody's mic is on. You want to say something? Okay. By mistake, it must have been switched on. You have to input what I was saying. You have to input X1, Y1, X2, Y2. Look, you are calling this as A, C. And you are calling this as B, D. You want to find out the distance. So this formula should become square root of A minus B the whole square. I hope you are understanding. X1 minus X2 the whole square, correct? A minus B the whole square plus Y1 is C minus D the whole square. This formula you have to write. Okay. Now, in Python, there is a library, there is a module given called math. Now, what is a module? Module is a bag. It's a bag containing lot of functions. Like, what do you want? You want to find square root of something? Use sqrt. What do you want? You want log of something? Use log. What do you want? You want to find e raised to something? Use exp. Many functions are given in math. You can think of math as a big bag in which there are a lot of functions given. But you have to use this bag. To use it, in the top of the program, you write import math. Don't worry, we are going to have a separate lecture of 3 hours or 2 hours on modules. What do you mean by these libraries, how they work, and so on. But the first line of the code must be import math. By saying this, you are announcing that you are interested in using math, the bag you want to use, that bag you are interested in using. And now you are allowed to use sqrt, square root, but you should use it as math dot square root. So from the bag, from this math bag, you are interested in picking the square root function, which will so easily tell you what is square root of something. For example, if you want to find square root of 25, just write square root bracket 25. This will be 5.0. Just after sqrt, you have the bracket, and in the bracket, you tell whose square root you want to find. That's so easy. So that's the way how you are going to find this square root. Okay. So let's try this code. Half the code, rather 90% of the code has been already written by our friend who wrote this code. The only thing is here, S will be the distance. Oh, lot of disturbance. Somebody is firing the rocket down there. Maybe John Abraham. The stupid people. So he can't do anything. But then here, what I was saying is S will be the distance between A, C and B, D. Okay. Now look how I am finding this. Math dot sqrt. Can I increase this zoom out maybe? Just let me try. Oh, this is too much. This is much better. Maybe you will be able to see this properly. So S is square root of something we are saying. Whose square root we want? Just check. Whose square root? A minus C the whole square plus B minus D the whole square. So how do I write it? Bracket. You know, square root is followed by bracket. Whose square root you want to find? So it is A minus C, correct? The whole square it is. That means A minus C into A minus C. I hope you are understanding. R square is nothing but R into R. So A minus C into A minus C. But wait. Again comes the mathematical rule. Multiplication will be done first. What do you say? Before subtraction, multiplication is done according to Bodmas rule. But we don't want multiplication first. We want the subtraction here. So, within the SQRT, we will give again a bracket. We will say, hello, A minus C is given in the bracket. Do this. And also, this A minus C is given in the bracket. Do this. This is perfectly A minus C into A minus C. And then, add this. What other quantity we had? B minus D the whole square. So, you'll say B minus D into B minus D. But same problem again. If you leave this as it is, then D into B will be done first. But you want B minus D to be done first. So, you'll give this in bracket. And you will give this in bracket. I hope you're understanding. And then one more bracket remaining for SQRT. See this open bracket? This one? This has to be closed. And then finally we will print length. Let's try this first, length. Okay. So I am ready to run the code. Hello. No, I am not ready to run the code. First things, I will have to import math because I am using services of that bag. So in the beginning, I will write import math. Don't worry. This is our first session. Be cool. Just imagine that math is a bag and we are using SQRT service. There is a service called SQRT. So we have to request, please give us math. So import math like that. So am I ready to run the code? No, not yet. Never ever run the code just in darkness. I want to run the code for length of the line, isn't it? Then I should be ready with some input. What I will do is, give me some time. Okay. What I will do is, I'll say, let me imagine a line which starts with 0, 0 and ends at 1, 0. This is the line. Now, I don't have to explain that length of the line is 1. Obvious, eh? Obvious. It is seen that length of this line is 1. So, this is the input I will give. This is x1, y1. This is x2, y2. So remember, x1, y1 is 0, 0. x2, y2 is 1, 0. So what will be the length? Length will be square root of, what was the formula? Hello, what was the formula? x1 minus x2 the whole square. So 0 minus 1 the whole square plus y1 minus y2 the whole square. So 0 minus 0 the whole square. This is nothing but, this is 1 square plus 0 square, which is square root of 1. Square root of 1 is 1. So length is 1. So let's try to run this. I just want to suggest all my dear students that run the program wisely, at least first time. After that, you can give any input. Okay. But to confirm whether the program is correct or not. Oh, what is all this? Let's run this. X1 is 0, you know. X1 and Y1 both are 0. X2 is 1. Okay. X1, Y1 is 0, 0. And Y2 is also 0. Good Lord, length is 1. Correct. My program is absolutely correct. This is how you find square root. Now, in today's class, you know, you might have observed that it's not so easy, although it's not that difficult also. It's not so easy to write expressions. Many times brackets are needed. Sometimes brackets are not needed. All these skills have to be developed as we proceed in our course. And these skills can be developed only by learning a variety of programs. As I told, I am not a teacher who will teach the fundamentals first and then programming. I believe in learning program and within the program you learn fundamentals. Anyway, I have a question like this. Suppose I have written an expression on paper like this. Z is equal to A plus B the whole square divided by C plus D the whole square. Oh no, not this one. I'm so sorry. I have written an expression like this. Z is equal to A upon B, B plus C, okay, into into D plus E upon F. Just check this expression. This can be arithmetic expression because I have written upon and all that neatly I have written. Now somebody tells us to write it in Python. Python. How will you write this? Z is equal to A slash, you will write B plus C. Now as soon as I write A slash B plus C, you know, this slash is having higher priority than plus. So A upon B will be solved first. And then A upon B will be added with C. So this expression has become A upon B plus C. Please try to understand. If I write the expression like this, then the expression has changed. It has become A upon B plus C. I don't want this. So I will give B plus C in bracket because I want B plus C to be done as a single unit and then divide it with A. Now this is multiplied with, check, this is multiplied with D plus E upon F. Now when I give D plus E slash F and leave it as it is, then you know that E upon F will be done first because division has higher priority. So this portion has indeed become D plus E upon F, which I didn't want. I want D plus E to be done first. So I will give this in bracket. Many such small little things should be understood before we go for some higher concepts. The mistake that happens is that students always start worrying about list, sets, dictionaries. And what are we going to do by learning those high-end concepts if you don't, I'm not saying you don't know, but if an average layman doesn't know how to write expressions in Python. Okay. Let me check. Anybody wants to say, if I make such an announcement, nobody will say anything. I mean, you will get used to my talk, and although I am a bit old, I am 50 years old. No. But still, being teaching students for more than 25 years, I have kept myself young due to all boys and girls who always interact so actively and full of energy. By the way, Nitin Rajbhar, is it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Nitin, did you get the point about the bracketing of the expressions and the priorities and all that? Yes, Nitin. Oops. Nitin?
Yes, sir. Can we?
Yeah. Did you get the point why the brackets were needed here? Really in the expression. Why B plus C needs a bracket, D plus E needs a bracket in this expression? Did you get that point? Did you understand?
Because they fixed the value.
No, I'm not asking you. I'm asking whether you understood this or not.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. An announcement, please feel free to unmute yourselves anytime. Anytime you can unmute yourselves and you can interrupt me and you can ask whatever you would like to add or whatever you feel that can this, what happens, I'll tell you, when you learn programming, any new language. Can this be written like that? Okay, teacher has written it this way. Can it be written in some other way? However silly it might be, however wrong it might be, or however correct it might be. I mean, who cares? Because everybody is sailing in the same boat here. So the active participation would really mean the lot of learning. Secondly, in every lecture, you know, I'll be at least giving you three such or four such codes to be written by you at that point itself. And then somebody will be interrogated. Sabko mauka milega baat karne ka yahan. और सबको बात करना ही है क्योंकि मैं तो सोचता हूं प्रोग्रामिंग सिर्फ बात करके ही समझ में आता है. यू नो आई सेड आई रेड मूलिश कूपर. दोस वो जॉइंड लेट मे नॉट बी नोइंग फर्स्ट लैंग्वेज आई लर्न वाज सी लैंग्वेज एंड द बुक आई रेड वाज रिटन बाय मूलिश कूपर. नाउ इट इज नॉट अवेलेबल. मूलिश कूपर ही सेड very sarcastic person. What Mulish Cooper said is actually you become a good programmer, or rather an excellent programmer, if you understand programs written by others. So what he meant by this line, you know, it's okay even if you can't write program. Literally he meant like that. It's okay initially if you don't know how to write program, but if you are able to cultivate that habit of learning what others have written to such an extent that when you read a program, you understand that to such an extent that you can explain it to 4-year-old kid, then you know programming. So just imagine Indrajit tells us how to write a program. And suddenly you get a new idea and you click that, okay, this line could have been written like that. That will spread our idea of programming. And that's how the active participation is a must. Somebody is on the chat. Wait a minute. Let me check. Okay, tomorrow the lecture is at 11 a.m. Just make a note of it. I think the same link, or maybe you can just paste this link, copy paste. Passcode is also given. Tomorrow we'll be meeting at 11. It's already 7:46. I've been talking for 1 hour 45 minutes. Tomorrow I will log in at 11. Expecting all of you to join. And I'll be telling you tomorrow, you know, I'll be telling you about the operators, how interestingly these operators work in Python. Let me scroll down. Let's check this. There are many operators, math operators, and how these work. This I will tell you tomorrow to start with. Okay. This is the feature I'll tell. Then second thing I will tell you tomorrow is something called formatted. Please give me some time. Oh, good Lord. What am I doing? Formatted outputs using print, which we saw today. But there is a function called format, very interesting function, which I will teach, which you will really like. And you will say, oh, it is so easy to print the things in Python like that. This I will teach, how to print formatted outputs in Python using format function. After that, I will tell you. I will tell you about some more programs, some 5 programs I will give, which are related to geometry, and about triangles or spheres and so on, some shapes, geometric shapes, so that we get some idea about ratio operator or division operator or multiplication operator and so on. So that will be our second lecture tomorrow. We are still in the fundamentals of Python. And once we know these fundamentals, I will immediately start with control structures. That means I'll tell you for loop, while loop. These 2 loops I will tell, and I will teach if-else statements. Before I log out today, I would like to make an announcement, or rather, this is something about me, that I am a teacher who doesn't believe in PowerPoint presentation. And I don't know whether you have attended any lecture in your college where teacher gives PowerPoint presentation, and at least I felt it too boring. Please excuse me if I am insulting any of your teachers. But I don't like colors. I don't like fonts. Please, I tell people, please don't show me that. Show me the code. Hello, show me the Python code. Why are you spending the time in this? So up and going since the beginning, I told you what is Python code. And the same thing we will be doing tomorrow at 11 a.m. 11 a.m. is where we are meeting tomorrow. Thanks very much. I am not waiting for anybody's doubts today. Okay. Okay. By the way, anybody wants to say something?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello, sir. Actually, yeah. I installed the Python now. Okay. But there is some doubt from my side. Means install the Python, but there is some displayed here a message like disable the path length limit. So can I click on this or close?
Disable the, what is that message? Disable the?
Disable path length limit.
Yeah, you click on that.
Yeah,
correct. Yes, yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Fine. Anybody else who wants to say something? Okay. So here we go. Good night, everyone.